Goedendag, welkom bij een nieuwe video over Europa. En gaan we natuurlijk beginnen met wat onwijs mooie foto's. 8 stunning images of black, so-called black of dark or original people in medieval Europe. Dus 8 mooie foto's. Gaan we eerst beginnen met 8 mooie foto's om even de argumenten te pakken en goed te kunnen visualiseren wat er nou echt wordt bedoeld. Want Europa in de Dark Ages, medieval, middeleeuwen, is gewoon niet hoe het ons geleerd is, hoe het ons in de boeken is geschreven en het perspectief wat we vandaag de dag dus van Europa hebben en van de Dark Ages. En dus het eigen beeld is dus niet correct en in lijn met wat er destijds echt is gebeurd, met wie het is gebeurd, waarom het is gebeurd en wie en waar is eigenlijk uit geschiedenis is geschreven. Deze mensen zijn uit geschiedenis geschreven. Dit zijn natuurlijk niet dezelfde mensen als in Afrika of Amerika, maar het zijn wel de Europese mensen die net 1492 naar Amerika zijn verscheept. Eerst als endured servitude, dan als slaaf. Oké, gaan we eerst beginnen met de introductie. Medieval times are without question one of the most recognizable periods in human history. Old England instantly comes to mind. The folklore of Robin Hood, King Arthur and Merlin the Magician are rapidly called to memory. Tough of knights clad in battle armor while jousting on horseback and easily recalled. We think of stone castles with moats, stained glass, windowed monasteries, straw-roofed villages, and brilliantly green pastures. Kings, queens, ladies, lords, monks, friars, musketeers, knights, and thespians and peasants, all highlighted by teams of heroism, bravery, chivalry en romance. En onthoud deze term, romance, Romani, rimmen. Dus het beeld dat we eigenlijk hebben van de middeleeuwen is van ridders, helden, dus koning Arthur, Robin Hood en al dat soort van de Shakespeare-verhalen komen bij ons in gedachten als we denken aan de middeleeuwen. We see these images clear as crystal, yet there is something of which many of us are blindly unaware. There were black people in medieval Europe. Net als je in films wel eens een random donkere of een random gemelaneerde persoon ziet, maar wel gewoon in alledaagse omstandigheden. Het valt niet op, maar mij ging het mij opvallen. Ik dacht van, hè, hoe kan dit? Think of the last time you watched a period movie set in England during the Middle Ages, zoals The Last King of England. Most likely people of color were noticeable absent, but like the unseen 92% of the iceberg that lies below ocean water, there was more diversity in Middle East Europe than meets the eye. A diverse world. Contrary to popular belief, there were black people and other form around the world seen in every corner and nook of society. There were generals, knights, saints, cardinals, nobility, conquistadors, mercenaries, musicians, cooks, housekeepers, and dock workers, slaves and assistants. They worked in yerbas, medical buildings, kitchens, gardens, and stables, living in Portugal, Spain, Austria, the Netherlands, France, Germany, Italy, and England. International trading cities such as Venice were multicultural magnets. It's time to rethink everything we know about the presence of black people in Europe during this time period. The picture of the Middle Ages isn't accurate without them. Dus het beeld, alles wat vandaag de dag gebeurt, gebeurde toen eigenlijk ook. En al die centrale punten, die drukkere grotere steden, waren toen ook al veel multicultureler dan dat we in beeld hebben. En het is gewoon onrealistisch en niet eerlijk en fout om ons daar uit de geschiedenisboeken te schrijven, of die mensen uit geschiedenisboeken te schrijven. Want dat anders klopt heel die geschiedenislijn niet. Niet. So if you're interested, I've dug through the archives to bring you some of my favorite images of people in the Middle Ages. Othello. This is Othello. 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 The Moorish general from William Shakespeare. Othello, maybe. Gaan we even kijken hoe hij erin ziet. Othello Shakespeare. Kijk hoe die hier af is gebeeld. Oh, wel realistisch. Oké. Okay. Othello, sorry. Othello, the Moorish general from William Shakespeare. Othello may be one of the most famous depictions of black person in medieval European history. Tough, though a fictional character, his story based on un Capitano Moro, a Moorish captain, by Italian writer Quintino, first published in 1565. A free kept Moorish captain. Dus in een vrije Moorische kapitein. Dus de vrije Moorische kapitein die in 1565 ruim 73 jaar na Columbus er zo afgebeeld werd. Waarom was het opeens naar 3? Oké, de King's Fountain. With its striking visuals, this well-constructed painting shows a lively street scene. The people are gathered around the Fountain of El Rey in Lisbon, Portugal, going about this in Portugal, going about their daily business. Crafted in the 16th century, it shows images of thriving. Dus we weten geen fuck, weten niks from the. We know nothing about the 16th century. It shows images of a thriving black African population. That's the hijack. The people appear to be a big part of the today-to-day happenings of town. One figure that stood out to me was on the bottom right. Look closely to do you see the Afro-Portuguese knight on a horseback? Astonishing. His garment is officially endowed with Herald of the Order of Santiago. Okay. You have to dig in this picture. Just view a square with fountain. Okay, the King's Fountain. The King's Fountain. Then painting. Look. So it's obviously they were free people. They were free. They were absolutely free. Look at this. How many royalty, slaves, normal people, busted people, just civilians. This king wears a cross of the Order of Santiago, which was founded in the 12th century. And so this man runs for this order, which was founded in the 12th century, around in the 1100s, and owes its name to the national patron of Galicia in Spain, Santiago, St. James the Greater. St. James, and whose banner the Christians began in the 19th century to combat and drive back the Moors and Muslims from the Iberian Peninsula. For in a field of square with King's Fountain, Dutch painting. Dit is een Nederlandse schilderij. Dus Nederlanders wisten in. Dus welke Iberiërs zijn in de reconstructie weggestuurd? Welke zogenoemde Joden zijn er nou echt in de reconquista weggestuurd? Als je vandaag de dag naar Spanje kijkt, welke Joden zijn weggestuurd? De Sibyl. Since ancient times, Sibyls were considered seers sent by God, priestesses foretelling to the coming of great events. This model served to depict the Sibyl of Agrippina, one of the 12 that foretold the coming of Christ. Notice the flagellum and crown of thrones, which are symbolic objects reminding the viewers of Christ's suffering. Look at her, the Sibyl, the wise man from the east. At this point, you will notice a trending them in medieval paintings, religion. In this one, we see Dutch the hijack, a man as one of the wise men visiting the newborn Christ. Yeah, Joshua Christ. Peter Cooker, the Adoration of the Magi, detail, Netherlands. In Nederland beelden dus de wijze man van het oosten zo uit af. Adoration of the Magi. Here's another iconic adoration scene. Following a star, three kings unite for a much anticipated meeting with baby Yahushua. They lay before him gifts of gold, frankincense and myrrh. Nederlands schilderij. Sir Morian, zo zwart als roet, the Black Knight of the Round Table. This gallant warrior was one of the men from the famed legend King Arthur. Dus koning Arthur ging Sir Morian. Gaan we eens even opzoeken. Wie is Sir? Sir Morian. Sir Morian. A Black Knight. Dus more natuurlijk bedoelen ze natuurlijk zwart. He was all black, even as I tell ye, his head, his body, and his hands were all black, saving only his teeth. His shield and his armor were even those of a Moor, and black as a raven. Illuminated manuscript, artist unknown, 1350. What the more images of black people in medieval Europe. South German painter, Saint Maurice, John Blanke. The Black Man in Western Art. Dus dit gaat dus over, zijn er gewoon een paar afbeeldingen van mensen met een hoog melaningehalte in Europa. Het is gewoon boeken die gekocht moeten worden. Maar hier gaan we aan komen. Hier gaan we aan komen. En hier gaan we nog verder in. Amazon. Oké, nu gaan we naar de informatie. The Image of the Black in Western Art Volume 2. Wauw. Zie je, stop het in het boek en de zogenoemde neger zal het nooit lezen. €106. Ah, €106. Zijn denk total price, 206. Snap je wat ik bedoel? Stop het in het boek en de neger zal het nooit lezen. En zeker geen €106 aan een boek besteden. Dus daarom, het is er, alleen verstopt. Maar ze verstoppen het niet voor niks. En ze gaan nooit niet voor niks die prijs naar €106. Misschien die 48 cent dollar, doen. Anders zouden ze dat nooit doen. Dan zouden ze die informatie nooit verbergen. From the Age of Discovery. The Age of Abolition, Part 1. Artists of the Renaissance and Baroque. Oh, dat wil ik. Deze Knights of Patron, Dominic de Man. Deze wil ik echt. Oké, was Columbus black, of course. Maar dat gaat het nu even niet om. Look at this. Medieval Europe, a land ruled by royal redbones and high yellas. Redbone is a term historically used in much of the southern United States to denote a multiracial individual with tightly curled hair. High yellow, aka yella, is a term for persons classified as black who also have a high proportion of white ancestry. It is a reference to the golden yellow skin tone of some mixed race people, often with tightly curled hair, Drake. For an example, gonna dig this over here, medieval, and we're gonna share with you this red bone, this song. It should be noted that blacks use those terms affectionately, as demonstrated in the original words of the state song of Texas, which of course was reworded by the albino people. Bermuda, the Yellow Rose of Texas. Let's go to that song, the Yellow Rose of Texas. Watch this also, Curry Mayo. How the Yellow Rose of Texas. The Yellow Rose of Texas. Let's go to that. And this of this of
this is a Okay, a little music, a bit of music. Originally conceived as a folk song
in early colonial Texas history, the first recorded copy of the Yellow Rose of Texas was handwritten on a piece of plain paper around 1836. Historical records indicate this copy was most probably transcribed either shortly before or just after General Sam Houston led his brigade of Texas loyalists against the army of General Antonio Lopez de Santa Anna at the Battle of San Jacinto, April 21, 1836. The folk song lyrics tell of a black American, presumably a soldier, who left his sweetheart a yellow rose and yearns to return to her side. Yellow was a term given to Americans of mixed race in those days. Black, blue, red, yellow, the primary colors, most commonly mulattoes, and rose was a popular feminine 19th century name frequently used in songs and poems as a symbolic glorification of young womanhood. The Emily of Morgan's Point refers to an endured servant somewhat forgotten in history for her heroism during the Texas War of Independence from Mexico. Some contend the legend is a myth, not a part of history. The historical evidence, however, indicates otherwise. The legend begins with the immigration to Texas of one James Morgan, an entrepreneur from Philadelphia with extensive holdings. We're coming to the point. Morgan was eager to capitalize on the cheap land and business opportunities in the Mexican colony, which would ultimately become Texas. He formed several partnerships with New York speculators for land deals in the fledgling colony. However, Texas did not permit slavery, and Morgan had 16 he wanted to bring with him. So to circumvent the law, he converted his slaves into 99-year endured servants. Dus om legaal mensen te laten werken en toch zijn slaven mee te kunnen nemen, heeft hij het contract naar 99 jaar een langdurig werkcontract veranderd. In the year that follows, a scheme was conceived to flood Texas with non-Mexicans from the United States to capitalize on that movement. Morgan returned to New York in 1935 to recruit more workers for his settlement. One such emerged was a 20-year-old woman. Was a 20-year-old woman named Emily D. West, an Eastern import with extraordinary intelligence and sophistication. Emily West was a mulatto and possibly from Bermuda, since original Bermudan America, since Morgan brought many of his workers from this Atlantic island. According to some records, West volunteered to be indentured, most probably to escape to prejudice against her mixed race, and as was the custom for an endured worker at the time, she changed her last name to that of Morgan's. By the following year, in 1936, the war for Texas independence from Mexico was fully engaged, led by General Sam Houston. James Morgan's now successful settlement, New Washington, was strategically located near the mouth of San Jacinto River. He freely gave his famous oranges, various grains, and feathered cattle to Houston's men. One particularly strategic parcel of land named Morgan's Point, so-called to this day, extended into San Jacinto Bay. From Morgan's Point, flatboats were loaded with supplies for Houston. This is the song. Quote, why should the Palatine boars... Okay. Why should the Palatine boars? We know, however, Morgan made certain, however, new Emily's heroism. He told everyone he accounted why. No. Oh, sorry. Quote, why should the Palatine boars, aka Germans, be suffered to swarm into our settlements and by herding together establish their language and manners to the exclusion of ours? Why should the Germans be suffered? Waarom zouden ze ondergaan to swarm into our settlements? Waarom zouden ze in onze settlements and by herding together establish hun land of taal en manieren zonder die van ons mee te nemen? Why should Pennsylvania, founded by the English, become a colony of aliens who will shortly be so numerous as to Germanize us instead of our Anglifying them, and will never adopt our language or customs any more than they can acquire our complexion? Which leads to me to add one remark. That the number of purely white people in the world is proportionable very small. All Africa is blue or tawny. Asia, chiefly tawny or yellow. America, exclusive of the newcomers, of the yellowcomers, woolly so, is red. Dus Afrika is so-called black, but that's, we know it's blue. Asia, chiefly tawny. America, also dark, blue, black, red, tawny, yellow. But in Europe, the Spaniards, Italians, French, Russian, and Swedes are generally of what we call a swarthy complexion. As are the Germans also, the Saxons only accepted, who with the English make the principal body of white people on the face of the earth. So, dus de enige Dus in Europa, de Spanjaarden, de Italianen, de Fransen, de Russen en de Zweden zijn over het algemeen wat we het noemen zwart. En zo zijn de Duitsers zijn ook zwart. De Saksen en de Engelsen zijn wit, zijn de enige blanke albino-rassen. I could wish their numbers were increased, and well, we are, as I may call it, scouring our planet by clearing America of woods and so making the side of our globe reflect a brighter light to the eyes of inhabitants in Mars or Venus. Why should we, in the sight of superior beings, darken its people? Why increase the sons of Africa by planting them in America, where we have so fair an opportunity, by excluding all blacks and tawnies, or increasing the lovely white and red? But perhaps I am partial to the complexion of my country, for such kind of personally is natural to mankind. Dus hij zegt hier, waarom zouden ze allemaal Afrikanen daar naartoe sturen als zij dat land ook kunnen uittippen en compleet voor hunzelf kunnen gebruiken? Dus het nieuwe witte land, zodat daar geen, dat al het kleur wat er is, niet meer is. Tot eigenlijk alleen maar red-achtig en white. Red and white. Red and white. Dus opnieuw. Dus opnieuw. 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 Which lead me to add one remark that the number of purely white people in the world is proportionable very small. All Africa is black or tawny. Asia, chiefly tawny. America, exclusive of newcomers, woolly so. And in Europe, the Spaniards, Italians, French, Russians, and Swedes are generally of what we call a swarthy complexion, as are the Germans also. The Saxons only expect who with the English make the principal body of the white people on the face of the earth. There are just two white races, the Saxons and the English, who are pure white people. So they want to claim America. They don't want to bring in black Africans because they want to wipe out the whole continent of America, cut it off of the wood and claim it for themselves, so that Mars can and Venus can shine a brighter light on them instead of on the darker people. So that's what's going on in the late 17th centuries. Swart, definitions of the term from above. Swart, a swart Gothic, Gothic. Swart, swart Dutch, a black, darkly brown, tawny, Spencer, a gloomy, malignant, too swart, from the noun to blacken, to dark brown, swartly, swarty, black, duskily, tawnily, swartiness, from swarty, darkness or complexion, tonic, swarty, swart, dark complexion, black, dusky, tawny, confirm. These definitions of swarty and tawny, as found in Benjamin Franklin's 71 essay, America as a Land of Opportunity, are taken from Samuel Johnson's Dictionary of the English Language, published by W.G. Jones in 1768, his searchable version of the digitized 1768 dictionary is available online at Google Books. Olivaster, when's darkly brown, tawny, olive. Dus tawny is olive. While the 30 Years' Wars against the Holy Roman Empire on the continent and the British Civil Wars in Britain during the 17th century were the principal impetus for insurgent albinos to depopulate Europe of its native people and natural kings. There were many other wars, so of its native people and his natural kings. There were many other wars and conflict which also contributed to the depopulation of blacks from Europe and into the Americas as slaves and indentured servants. The Jacobite rebellions in Britain, so remember the name Jacobite rebellions in Britain being of prominence, the method was of course by ship. Typical is the voyages of the ship Jamaica Galley, sailing from Rotterdam, Holland, dus vanaf Rotterdam, Holland, to the coast in England, then to Philadelphia. 7 februari 1738, the ship carried a cargo of Palatine mills, electoral Palatine or country Palatine of the Rhine, Germany. Dus Nederlanders hebben vanuit Rotterdam, zijn ze naar Engeland gegaan, hebben ze dus een schip, Duitse Swarties meegenomen, en Sturk State of the Black Holy Roman Empire. The immigrant ship Transcribers Guild maintains a database on the internet with a list of ships and people transported. Adolf Hitler in his book Mein Kampf referred to the 30-year wars as setting the tone of modern Germany. Hier is wat hij zegt. Dus Hitler wist natuurlijk wie de echte Duitsers waren en het Arische ras. Het Arische ras. Wat is het Arische ras? Het Iranian ras, Aryan, Tartaria, alles Caucasian, albino. Wat weten we nog meer? Here's what he said. Quote. Here Hitler states, without philosophical elaboration, the doctrine which some groups of German intellectuals accepted as a bridge across which a German mind could pass to National Socialism. Civilization means the application of reason to life, a process which scored its greatest triumphs while Germany was struggling to emerge from the deepest of the 30-year war, Goethe, Schiller, Kant, not to mention Lessing and Wieland, are reflections of the Western minds rather than original creators of the German soul. Dus al deze mensen zijn reflecties meer van het westerse denkbeeld dan de Germaanse ziel. Even the great medieval empire was based upon the triumph of Christianity. Therefore, the patriot prefers to seek out the life forces, the irritational impulses which seem to him more characteristic of the German mind. The decision is sometimes caught in desperate phraseology. When I hear the word culture, wrote Hans Jons, the first official Nazi playwright, quote, unfortunately, our German nationality is no longer based on racially uniform nucleus. Also, the process of the blending of the various primal constitutes has not yet progressed so far as to permit speaking of a newly formed race, the Aryan race, the pure, no mix with Middle East, no West, just West Europe, just West Asia. One, on the contrary, the blood poisoning which affected our national body, especially since the 30-year wars, led not only to a decomposition of our blood, but also of our soul. The open frontiers of our fatherland, the dependence upon un-Germanic alien bodies along these frontier districts, but above all the strong current influx of foreign blood into the interior of the Reich proper, in consequence of its continued renewal, does not leave time for an absolute melting. It is not a new race that results from the fusion, but the racial stock remains side by side, with the result that especially in critical moments, when in order cases a herd would assemble, the German people run in all directions of the winds. The racial elements are situated differently, not only territorially, but also in individual cases within the same territory, keeping in mind that Hitler, like albinos, routinely lied or twisted truth and fact to suit his purpose. Treachery of the albinos. As realized history indicates, once the Central Asian albino, aka the white man, invaders of the modern era, circa 0 to 600 AD, as differentiated from the ancient albino invaders related to the Latin and Greeks, had sufficient numbers in Europe, they resolved to turn the tables and establish a new paradigm, one where they were the masters. To this end, they fought over 250 wars in Europe between 1066 and 1795, ending with the annihilation and expulsion of Europe's blacks in the 17th, 18th, and the 19th centuries. So, ending with annihilation and expulsion of Europe's blacks. Flush with the victory of Europe's blacks, they initiated the technological arms race with an eye towards killing or subjugating all who did not fully share their defect, all people who would have an advantage over them. This dream of complete albino domination over the world first began to take shape when the British began to take control in China in 1760. It was furthered along 1854 with the Japanese capitulated to Commodore Perry, and then the final piece fell into place when the British took India in 1858. After that, primitive Africa and other such places were child's play. Most blacks in America had already been killed. Thus, the 20th century started with the genetically damaged, physically weakest, and numerical smallest Central Asian albinos ruling the entire world. But power was not enough. They also wanted a glorious history and past as befitting their newfound circumstances. They wanted respect. They wanted face. They began the lies, their false stories, and creation of fake artifacts that has completely obliterated ancient history until now. Dus nadat eigenlijk Afrika kinderspel was om over te nemen, omdat eigenlijk in die tijd de goede, beste mensen goede bedoelingen hadden, en dat ging natuurlijk met leugens en shit. Nadat dus hier zijn dus in deze tijd 250 oorlogen geweest, en hier hebben ze dus Engeland in 1760, China overgenomen, 84 Japan en 58 Indonesië. En in Amerika waren de meesten al dood. Maar nadat ze alles veroverd hebben, hebben ze dus de hele leugen verteld. Omdat ze in dat opzicht een cultuur wilden hebben. En alle glorification is naar hun toegegaan. History is not my story. En dat is het hele punt. Alles is verdraaid, verschreven om maar het eigen beeld zo goed mogelijk te brengen. It is written that Thomas Cromwell, not Oliver, was responsible for destroying 97% of Britain artifacts during the mid-1500s, presumably almost of all Britain black artifacts, but some few have survived from all over Europe, albeit undoubtedly whiteness. So whitewashed. Here are some of them. Isabel Clara Eugenia of Austria. Painting. She was daughter of Philip II of Spain and his third wife Elizabeth of Valois. She was sovereign of the Habsburg Netherlands in the Low Countries and the north of modern France, together with her husband Albert VII. Dus zij is als een sovereign of de Nederlandse lage landen, Habsburg. Jeton, token coin like middle, with portraits of Albert II, Archduke of Austria and Infanta Isabel of Spain in Antwerpen. Elizabeth of Valois, as a four-year-old, Bibliothèque Nationale de France, to become a Spanish queen as third wife of Philip III. Elizabeth Valois, Elizabeth Valois, Philip II, Page of Her Mother, Catherine de Medici, Books of Our Bibliotheque, Look at Philip II, Don Carlos of Spain, the eldest son of the higher apparent of King Philip II of Spain. Look at this yellow, yellow-ish. The Elector Johann Georg of Brandenburg and his wife Elisabeth von Anhalt by Heinrich Rapsuch, Berlin, der Barfusser Church Historical Museum, Basel, Switzerland. Mary Queen of Scots, drawn well in mourning for her husband, Francis II, King of France. Look at these girls. A portrait of Medal of Anne Boleyn, inscribed. Medal was made of prototype for comrade against those of a black woman. Elizabeth inscribed Tulsi. She has a swarthy olive complexion like that of mother. So she made a habit of whitening it with a lotion made up of egg white, powdered eggshell, poppy seed, borax, and alum, which made her face appear white and luminous. From her father, she had her red natural curly hair. So they foundationed it with some milk. Louis Rouvroy, Duke of Saint-Simon. Born in Paris to a family of ancient nobility, he was educated a gentleman and was a musketeer at age 16. Later, he entered the service of Philip, Duke of Orleans. Saint-Simon gives this portrait of Philip, who was a homosexual. Monsieur was a little man. He always wore high-heeled shoes and was always dressed up in a feminine way. So, together... om een beeld te krijgen van Europa in de jaren, in de middeleeuwen, de dark ages, de donkere jaren. Misschien valt die term nu beter. Niet dat, zeg maar, ze waren zwart, ze waren donker, ze waren olief, ze waren bruin, maar ze waren ook gewoon rood. Ze hadden sproeten en ze maakt hun gezicht lichter eigenlijk dan nodig. En dit is eigenlijk hoe iemand met een, ja, de complexieschaal, earth, yellow, undertones, jewels, red, blue, copper, en khaki, gold, tawny, is even een voorbeeld te krijgen van wat er dus zwarties, brownies, beiges, white, en heb je natuurlijk tawny, orange, brown, yellowish, brown. Dus hier krijgt hij ook ginger of rood haar van. Terracotta. Hij is natuurlijk Martin Luther King color. En red bone. Dus krijg je die foto van net. Krijg je een beetje de light skin, brown skin, dark skin. Ja, dat is allemaal tonen en termen natuurlijk. High yellow, yellowish, pale, rosy, reddish. Dus zijn de tinten eigenlijk van de albino's, maar ja, Hayella kan natuurlijk ook met kroes en zo zagen dus eigenlijk die mensen, de koningen, op dat moment in Europa eruit. In Europa, omdat het heel multicultureel was. Het was natuurlijk al vermengd, vermixt. Een plek nog één keer, zo zagen de zwarties dus in Europa eruit. Dat is toch prachtig, dat is toch mooi. Dat is toch goud. Dit is toch goud. Is toch groot. En ja, Black Tudors, dus er is gewoon bewijs. En die boeken zijn €106 zo te zien. In zo'n Black Western Art. Dus dit is gewoon bewezen. Dit is gewoon zo. En het staat hier gewoon in beeld. We hebben gelezen hoe dus de albino's, de ook al Hitler, dus het zwarte Germaanse gas gewoon compleet wilde uitwissen. En de Engelsen. En dus ook gewoon zo'n gas zoals, weet je, Franklin. Eigenlijk door heeft dat zij het minste zijn. Maar toch willen ze alles veroveren. Alles pakken. Alle landen en continenten. Willen ze gewoon uitroeien en vermoorden. De leiding er dan. En dat feit is gewoon uit geschiedenis geschreven. Hoe mensen deze bands zijn ontstaan, is ook uit geschiedenis geschreven. En hoe dit white is gebarst, is dus gasten zoals Columbus. Was Columbus black? Zo'n gast als Columbus eigenlijk gewoon helemaal weer wit te wassen. As you consider the case we make, please remember that you have been trained to see the world and history through the eyes and ears of humankind's most degenerate liars and destroyers, the albinos. Through the pages of real history, we have murmured that it seems like the albinos were willing to accept the blame for every and all manner of crimes against humanity. Dus ze hebben, zeg maar, ze willen alles voor zich opnemen, maar ze willen ook alle trotsen dus opnemen. Dus al het goede en al het slechte zou zogenaamd door alleen maar albinos worden gedaan. But still, we assume that albinos would draw the line at Hitler and Columbus. They being the creators responsible for more loss of human life than any others. Luckily, there is no possibility of blacks being settled with the sins of Hitler, because we have reams of photographic evidence that he was a full-blooded albino. Whereas Columbus is another case. Entirely, there is no authentic portrait of him, only the usual make it up as you go line of fake albino portraits. These are from the albinos at Wikipedia. Posthumous portrait of Christopher Columbus, Sebastian del Piombo. There are no known authentic portraits of Columbus. Colombo. Christopher Columbus as imaged by the albinos. Christopher Columbus as imaged by the albinos. There was fake portraits that we were quite willing to accept as real, because of course we wanted no parts of the legacy of that most wasted piece of human dung, Columbus. So we gladly let albino Italians in their delusion make brotherhood with that bomb. But then we saw this. Painting titled The Voyage of Columbus by Arthur Cotgan, who was an English painter and illustrator. The painting is an illustrator from the book This Country of Ours, the Story of the United States by Henrietta Elizabeth George H. Doran Company. So, what is look is at least he's Tawny, at least as op zijn minst Tawny olijfachtig, knowing that albinos never ever make fake artifacts depicting blacks as important people in history, we immediately checked to see if A.C. Michael was an albino. He was. Then we checked to see if he might have been an albino sympathetic to the black cause. We had done many paintings of blacks, and in sympathy might have slipped in a black Columbus. But no, his paintings do not feature blacks, but sometimes the heroic character of a painting may be depicted as dark. So then the task is to discover why the albino man A.C. Michael depicted the criminal Columbus as a black man, and why the albino woman Henrietta Marshall chose to put it in her book about the founding of the United States. We think that perhaps A.C. Michael might have been a student of the late medieval period in Europe, and through research may have concluded that Columbus must have been a dark man. So following that logic, let us take a look at Columbus and those times to see who was who and who was doing what. Oh my, so talking about the tribal gang on gang trade, or just do we talk about, praten we over kleur op kleurshandel, praten over wit op zwart handel? Was Columbus a dark or a white man? We don't know. We gaan er later achter komen. Boom, 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 boom. What? Thank you all. Misery tried for nursing her albino child. Omo Valley, Ethiopia. Dus albinism is common. Is komt gewoon voor op elk continent. Wederom, bedankt voor het kijken. Keep it up. Want we gaan zo belachelijk veel dingen over Europa ontkrachten en opnieuw leren. Vergeet alsjeblieft wat je hebt geleerd en gekregen hebt van Europa. Je weet niks. 16th century is an unknown book. It's complete fraud. It's complete twisted 180 degrees. Oké. Okay. Thank you all.